Good morning. Good morning. Welcome to First Presbyterian Church. We are so glad that you are gathering with us for worship. If you're a guest, a special welcome to you. We hope that you will sense God's presence with you as you worship and that you will be welcomed warmly by the congregation. If you are a guest, we would love to get to know you better and would request your help in doing so. If you're in the sanctuary, there are connect cards in the pew in front of you. Our hope is that you might consider filling one of those out and make it your offering this morning, putting it in the offering plate, which is in the back on your way out of the service. If you are joining us online, we'd love for you to send us an email and say hello. Our goal is simply to get to know you, answer any questions that you have, and welcome you more fully into the life of the church. These are an exciting few weeks, and so I just want to cue you about all that is happening in the life of the church so that you don't miss anything. We keep reminding you that June 5th is Pentecost Sunday. It will be an extra special Sunday in the life of our church. It's Covenant Renewal Sunday, and we intend on that morning to reflect on these past few years and give thanks for God's faithfulness to us in the midst of the pandemic. To celebrate our life together. It will be a time you don't want to miss. Not only will the celebration take place in our worship service together, but afterwards and throughout. I'm not part of these plans, but I hear carnival-like things taking place in the front yard, special food, just lots of joy on that day. As we then, having reflected on God's faithfulness, renew our covenant together around worship, service, and giving as we go forward into the year to come. Here again, there'll be a document that we're invited to sign. It'll sit in the history hallway for years and years to come. And so you'll want your name on that. You don't want to miss that Sunday, so make every effort to be with us. Of course, today is also a very exciting day. This is Confirmation Sunday in the life of our church. It's always one of the highlights of the year. Many of us understand what confirmation is, but there may be some who are new into the life and kind of system of our church, and so let me just hold up for a point of celebration what we're doing this morning. These eight young men and women were, when they were very, very small, offered by their parents before the church and before God. And their parents made vows to raise them in the faith. Some of them, that happened right here in this spot. For others, it happened in another congregation, but saying vows that are very, very similar. From that point forward, the church, you have poured your life into these children. Now, you've been Sunday school teachers. You've given sacrificially to the church, helped them go to camp. You've looked the other way when kids were kids and said, I'm just glad they're in here with us in worship. You've nurtured them to this point where they are going to confirm their faith, take hold of it for themselves. And so this is a day not only to celebrate them, but to celebrate us and to celebrate God's presence in our midst and the life that He has given us to share together. And so I'm really glad that you're here this morning. May we sense God's Spirit enabling us to celebrate as we worship. With that, allow me to pray, and then Pastor Jason will lead us in the call to worship. Lord Jesus, thank you for this very special day you've set before us. Thank you for these young people who will affirm their faith and begin to journey anew with you. Thank you for this congregation, this family of faith that seeks to walk together and care for each other as we all point one another to you. As we come into worship, Lord, we pray for just that very thing. That as we sing, as we pray, as we come before your word, as we reaffirm our faith together, as we seek to encourage and support these young people, that you, Jesus, would be glorified by our life and worship together. We need your help, Holy Spirit, for that to be true. And so come, make us aware of your presence and help us to worship, we pray, in your name. Amen. Could I invite you to stand as Pastor Jason leads us in the call to worship?
Good morning. Good morning. Join me in this call to worship. Come, make a joyful noise to God and all the earth. Sing about the glory of his name and give to him glorious praise.
How awesome are your deeds, O God.
Let all the earth worship him and sing praises to him.
Let us sing praises to your holy name.
Alleluia. Christ is risen.
He is risen indeed. Alleluia.
I would like to thank the man for that. God, that we are. Hallelujah. And as God fully together, the right to that. Remembering of our baptism today, Christian students, the baptismal vows we offer is prayer. So I offer a also pray together corporately. So join me in prayer. For your sake, we confess that we have not word, we have done. Give you thanks. Grant us grace to die in sin, as daily to in Christ, who lives and reigns with you, and in whose strong name. Now is the time for a confession. is because of the we do indeed just new life in Christ with forgiveness for our sins. We confess our in the name of Jesus Christ. Given right with God, but also be with peace of the peace with one another, sign of
we can for the ministry choir. I'd encourage you now to be seated and allow them to worship. Godspeed. Amen. Thank you. Make their way into the and when they do, the come forward and them will read the of faith. And so let me talk about that a little bit. And we have 8 people confirmed this morning. Before them already had the expression worked in their life through the church, and at this point, there are two in the church. We had 4 this morning, only few statements at the moment, but all eight afterwards. Made infants with their that this is a to but for you guys are really are you we way right slow these people here Braden, are you first?
St. Holt's Mommy South Time Friend. These ones in Christ as we enter classes together. I was born part of the church at a young age in school and to the I was from before the time. Centered around experienced sin in my life. I've always been honest. I've seen my parents and judgment, which is never in God 3-6. Odd moment people had, but I in itself to take belief. It's given every the gift to get athletic become a pop 2 verse. Or to others themselves looking to yourself. I envision it as but to continue to get more involved in help out with the children's ministry and volunteering school. My love is never even more by serving them.
What is our hope? What is our hope in my life? Is only
was away to leave short period. Very hard. Serves I had this when I helped at children to see that children to one another. We have grace Romans 13 for shall no longer be your as you are under law, but under you under loved my
J S Bach, 3 years old, and I some of my interests sports and hanging out with friends. When I was born, I was baptized when I was a baby. Growing up, I went to Sunday school. I took and learned about many stories in the Bible. During the pandemic, we stopped going to those who were not involved with church and the friendships I had. While away from church, I started to notice a change in myself. I would make some bad decisions. I was selfish and didn't always think about others. In Philippians chapter 2, verses 3 and 4, it teaches do nothing out of selfish ambition or vain conceit. Rather, in humility, value others above yourselves, not looking to your own interests, but each of you to the interests of others. I feel like my selfishness came from a lack of learning about sin and not going to church. In sixth grade, I started going to youth groups with my friends that participated in the church. That made me miss going to church and miss the church family. When I started confirmation, we learned how to pray. These last 4 months, I have been starting to pray more and making better decisions. My grades have went up since I started, and I've been a better person. What really touched my heart was the church summer camp last year named Surf City. I learned a lot there. It really opened my eyes. My relationship to God became a lot closer. That made me realize how much I was missing church and saw how much people and God really love me. In the future, I can use my abilities to serve the church by being more involved. In Matthew chapter 5, verse 16, it states, "In the same way, let your light shine before others, that may see your good deeds and glorify your Father in heaven." Therefore, I would like to serve the less fortunate at Mosaic Ministries or by being an usher on Sunday mornings. I am going to get involved with the church by going to youth groups, voting, going to camps, and maybe helping with Sunday school. I can even show love to my peers by inviting them to church and church services. I really want to serve others in the church and help serve others in the community through God and using God's help. I want to be a member of the church, and I will help God do his work. I affirm my Christian beliefs. Thank you for listening.
Oxford, and I'm a confirmation student this year. When I was younger, God did not matter to me as much as he does now. When I was a kid, church felt like an obligation, and I felt like I was required to attend with my family. My earliest memories from church was when I attended children's church. I felt like it was a fun thing to do each week, but I didn't understand the importance of how God worked in my life. Now that I've been through confirmation, my faith has drastically changed. Since I understand my religion in a more in-depth way, one way I've seen my life change is that I enjoy going to church on Sundays because I can connect to my worship experience. I've connected to Jesus in many new ways. I have been following Christ a lot more than before confirmation. Now that I have a better understanding of Christ, I have seen myself change a lot. I've noticed myself being happier and even showing my faith with my friends. I have become less worried about my life now that I know God and all that he does for me in my life. One of my bigger God moments was when I felt his presence while I was dancing, and he guided me to making the correct long-term decision. Psalms 37:5 says, "Commit your way to the Lord, trust in him, and he will act." I'm looking forward to using my gifts from God to serve my church. One way I plan on doing this is by helping lead children's church. I'm excited to be a part of First Presbyterian Mommy and be active in continuing to grow my relationship with my church family and God. Thank you to my church family and my mentor, Mrs. Hoskins, for making my confirmation experience a memory I will always remember and a wonderful experience.
Unto the grave, what will we say? Unto the
give thanks to God for the life he's given us to live together, and appreciation for these young people who bravely shared about that life. Let's do that together. You guys can be seated. We continue on in the story of Scripture as we're guided by something called a lectionary. We began in Genesis and moved all the way through the Old Testament and the Gospels and Acts, and now we have just a few weeks left where the lectionary tees up for us the letter to the church in Philippi, otherwise known as Philippians. Because of our focus on the confirmation students this morning, I'll not take as much time with this as I normally do, but I do want to lift it up before us and at least allow the words of Scripture to inform this experience we're sharing together, because I think there may not be a more appropriate book of the Bible for what we're celebrating right now. So I'd invite you to turn to the book of Philippians, and we're going to start right at the beginning, chapter 1, verse 1. Who's got the page number? 1178. We can always count on Dr. Strunk. He gets there first. 1178. Hey, you teased me in the first service. 1178. As you're turning there, let me kind of set this up and help you understand why I think this is just the most appropriate book of the Bible for this time that we share. It's a letter written by the Apostle Paul. We've been introduced to him over the last few weeks. As he always does in the letters he writes, he introduces himself right at the outset. But you will notice that it's not just the Apostle Paul who introduces himself in this letter. That instead, it is both Paul and his student or protege in the faith, Timothy, who are lifted up as the source of this letter. Our confirmation process puts the focus on both the student and a mentor from within the church. And so this is an appropriate, inclusive book for this moment. It's a letter written from Paul and Timothy to the whole church, to overseers and elders and deacons, to all of us as we are journeying together. Paul writes it from a prison cell in Rome. And certainly he is wondering whether this is the end for him. As he wonders whether this might be the end, he reflects on the meaning of life, on the key to living, on the purpose of it all. And so it's right, both at the end and, young men and women, at the beginning, which I hope you see this as the beginning, to reflect on what does this all mean? What's the key to life? What's the purpose? That will be brought into focus in the book of Philippians. Again, I'll just be reading a few verses, but I commend it to you for your own reading, maybe for your own study this summer. Someone said, what are we reading this summer? The Bible reading runs out. Well, maybe you want to consider carefully going through the book of Philippians on your own. This morning, however, we'll read verses 1 through 11. Now, we're assigned through 18, but I'm going to stop at 11 and allow three verses in particular to draw our focus on what we share together this morning. So, Philippians chapter 1, verses 1 through 11. Allow me to pray, and then I will read. Oh Lord, we thank you for your word. Your word is given that we might know you, that we might recognize ourselves, that we might find and walk in the way you have called us to. Your word is truth. Your word is life. And so, Holy Spirit, would you take these words and impress them upon us, all of us, but especially these young 8 people who are beginning their journey in a new way with you this morning. We pray this in the name of Jesus. Amen. Hear God's word to you. Paul and Timothy, servants of Christ Jesus, to all God's holy people in Christ Jesus at Philippi, together with the overseers and deacons, grace and peace to you from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. I thank my God every time I remember you. In all my prayers for all of you, I always pray with joy because of your partnership in the gospel from the first day until now. Being confident of this, that he who began a good work in you will carry it on to completion until the day of Christ Jesus. It is right for me to feel this way about all of you, since I have you in my heart. And whether I am in chains or defending and confirming the gospel, all of you share in God's grace with me. God can testify how I long for all of you with the affection of Christ Jesus. And then these next three verses are what I want us to focus on together. And this is my prayer, that your love may abound more and more in knowledge and depth of insight, so that you may be able to discern what is best and may be pure and blameless for the day of Christ, filled with the fruit of righteousness that comes through Jesus Christ to the glory and praise of God. Amen. Paul writes with gratitude and love for the church, and so too do we as the church gather around you with gratitude and love and excitement for all that life has in store for you. Paul expresses the deepest longings or desires of his heart at the beginning of verse 9. I want to have it before us again right here. It reads, "And this is my prayer, that your love may abound more and more in knowledge and depth of insight." This is the deepest expression, most important, most desirous longing of Paul's heart. Why do we know that? Well, because it takes its form in prayer. Isn't this true of you? That the things that are most important for you, the people that are most important for you, find their way into your prayers. Listen, I'm not talking about the routine prayers before dinner or those types of things, but the quiet prayers, the private prayers, the desperate prayers. This is what takes form here. And so Paul gives expression to this. What does he pray for? What does he desire more than anything else for those he loves? What do we desire for these gathered here? That they get into a good college? That they get a good job? That they excel on the field or on the court? That they get good grades? That they find a loving partner? All of these are good desires, right? But they ought not be the primary. They ought not be the first desire in our heart. Paul gives that first desire that should be true for the whole church. It's right here. Four letters. Starts with an L. Ends with an E. What's the greatest desire? Okay, if you didn't get that one, I knew we were in trouble, right? Right, this is the key, the purpose of life, he says. That you might recognize and take hold of and live out love. It's why the church has adopted as our motto, love first, a two-word expression of the gospel. It's why the greatest commandment centers on love. Love the Lord your God with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength. Love your neighbor as yourself. All the law, Jesus says, boils down into these things. Our heart's desire is that you would know love. Where does love come from? Scripture goes on to suggest it. Where does love come from? It comes from knowledge. It comes from depth of insight. You notice that those are not primarily feeling words. Our culture speaks about love as if it's a feeling. Do you feel love? You fall in love with someone? You fall out of love with someone? That's not the love we're talking about. The love we're talking about is rooted in history. It's rooted in action, and it's rooted in knowledge and experience in this world. Paul says, "My prayer is that you would know love through knowledge and depth of insight." And you would know it more and more and more and more. Another way to translate that word that here is may abound more and more is to overflow. So I think it provides a great word picture for us as we gather on this Confirmation Sunday. Because here's what's been happening, we hope and pray, is that ever since your parents held you before the church and before the Lord, many people, your parents, Sunday school teachers, the church, they've been pouring into you the love of Jesus Christ. They were your VBS, not only Bible teachers, but game leaders, right? And some people, they gave sacrificially money so that you could go to camp. Some of you talked about how important camp was to you. Did you hear that? When you provide, whether it's through the offering plate or a special opportunity, you send these kids to camp, and it's a way they learn of God. You've come into the worship service, and I bet when you were little, you might have even been a little squirmy, right? Your parents were like, shh, 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 shh. And people around you, they had to let this internal battle going, right? They're trying to focus, and yet there's this kid up here that's distracting them. And most of the time, They bit their lip and said, I'm just glad this little one is in church. That's one way to pour into the knowledge and love of Jesus. Well, gang, they've filled your cup. And so now here is our prayer, taken out of verse 9, that your love may now abound more and more and overflow into the world all around us. This is the gospel, is it not? As we all gather around the baptismal font, this is the hope for all of us, for none of us are done. And we desire that the love of Christ be poured into our life. Verse 10, so that, anytime you see an expression like so that, you got to pay attention because here's the purpose, right? So that you may be able to discern what is best. In a moment, you're going to stand up here and say vows. You already said them this morning, so you're remembering, right? One of those vows calls you to turn away from evil and turn towards Jesus and his good. I think it's an important vow, but I really don't think it's a vow that will challenge you. For I know you all well enough to know, you're not really tempted by evil all that much. You're good kids. You're becoming good adults. I think the challenge that you will have, and that frankly many of us have, is not discerning good from evil. Instead, it will be discerning the best from the good. Do you notice that in this verse? Paul prays that the love of Christ might overflow in your life so that you would be able to discern what is best. Boy, there's so many good things in this world. Right? Really, really good things. You've named some of them. You know, you have opportunity to engage in sports and give yourself to music and dance and you have technology like we didn't even dream of when we were your age, right? And you're into that point where you're leaning into relationships now, and I pray that will be good and all of these things, but the challenge for you now is figuring out, okay, all of this stuff is good, but what's the best? Some of you gave expression to that in your statement of faith, and I was really joyful to hear it. Some of you talked about athletics. I know some of you, because I asked you this morning, you ran track, and so an image came to mind that I think will be helpful if you'll trust me and go watch the movie Chariots of Fire. Right? You know this movie. It's the story of Eric Liddell. Eric Liddell was a follower of Christ who lived in Great Britain in the early 1900s. He was a runner. Is running good? Not a rhetorical question. Is running good? Yes. He was a really good runner, so much so that he was an Olympian. Are the Olympics good? Yeah, the Olympics are good, right? He was not only a runner who was going to the Olympics, he was favored to win his event at the Olympics. The whole ambition of his life was about to boil over in this moment until he discovered that the race he was to run came into conflict with the expression and living out of his faith. And so the story in Chariots of Fire is how he wrestled with that, and what God did with his faithful wrestling. I'm not going to give away the ending. I want you to go watch the movie. But one of the famous lines of the movie, I think I heard maybe Elizabeth say something similar in your statement of faith, because Liddell says, I feel God's pleasure when I run. Didn't you say, I feel God's pleasure when you dance? Presence when you dance, same thing. That's good. So go watch this movie. Get past it's a 1980s movie, and so the color's weird, and it's probably like ninja talking and all of that. Just get past that. It's a good story. Because God wants to fill us so with his love that we are going to be able to discern in this world the best from the good, so that we might be pure and blameless for the day of Christ. Let's check one another on that. How are you doing with being pure and blameless so that when you stand before Jesus, he'll be all good and confident. How you doing with that? Yeah, that's right. See, friends, let's remember the gospel. To choose the best doesn't mean choosing an activity. To choose the best doesn't mean developing a talent. To choose the best means choosing Jesus. Because the gospel tells us that it is through relationship with Jesus that we can then come and stand before the throne. And when we do, he will say, "You're pure, you're blameless, you're ready." Why? Because of your action in the world? No. But because of Jesus' sacrifice for you. So the best amongst all the good in this world is Jesus. So I'm so grateful for the vows that you're going to make today, because they're vows about a relationship with Jesus. And we pray that these won't be just vows that you make today, but that they'll be vows that you offer to yourself and to God daily as you seek to know him. As you do, good things are going to happen. Some of you gave expression to that. Was it you, Brock, that said, once I started following Jesus again, my grades got better? Amazing how that works. Yeah, because look at what verse 11 says, right? When you do this, you're going to be filled with the fruit of righteousness. But you never thought of grades as a fruit of righteousness. But it is, sure, that comes through Jesus Christ to the glory and praise of God. He will fill you with good things like love and joy and peace and faithfulness, good grades, and the ability to bless the world. Because you've chosen Jesus, who is the best. Confirmation is not the end. Can't be the end. Can we be honest about that? I'm not necessarily speaking about this church, but I was talking to the Catholic priest a couple of weeks ago, Father Schild, because I saw that they did, some ceremony in their church, and I said, what do you do with the families that's the only time they show up? And we kind of lamented that a little bit together. I'm glad that that's not our norm. But it is a temptation, is it not? That often what happens is you present a child for baptism, then maybe you come and bring them to Sunday school, and then once you get to confirmation, everyone's like, whew, done. It's on them now. Well, it is kind of on you, to a degree. But we are far from done. None of us are done. Confirmation is the beginning of walking with Christ for the rest of our lives, walking together as his body, as family called together in this place. And so may you sense the Spirit of God and the people of God walking with you in even greater ways from this point forward. Let's pray together. Lord Jesus, we do thank you for this life that you have given us. And we pray that we would sense your presence as we continue to journey towards you. We recognize from this passage and others like it that there will come a day when you return. There will come a day when this journey is over. We don't know when that day is, but we know that if we walk with you, we'll be ready for it whenever it comes. And as we walk with you, you will bless us and fill us with the fruit of righteousness, with all the good things that you desire for our life. We pray that for these young people. We pray that still for ourselves. Not for our own glory, Lord, but for the glory of the name of Jesus Christ. It's in that name that I pray. Amen. All right. Well, let's come forward and reaffirm these vows before God's people and before God together. If you are a mentor, you are welcome to come forward as well. Stand behind the young person that you have been guiding over these past months. Okay, spread out. I know you guys are like good friends, but you're just hugging each other and spread out. There you go. Landon can't even get back there.
All right. On behalf of session, I present Elizabeth Axford, Lily Cowdery, Kendall Nye, Brock Sainholtz, Braden Sainholtz, Elizabeth Tierney, Owen Tolbert, and Brody Zilke for the reaffirming of the baptismal covenant into which they were baptized. They now desire to publicly confess their faith and to assume greater responsibility in the life of the church and God's mission in the world.
You come to us as members of the one holy Catholic Church into which you were baptized long time ago and by which you have been nurtured. We are one with each other, sisters and brothers in the family of God. We rejoice in the gifts you bring to us. As you join with us in the worship and service of this congregation, it is fitting that together we reaffirm the covenant into which we were baptized, claiming again the promises of God which are ours in baptism. In baptism, we remember what the scripture says about who we are. One example comes from the book of 1 Peter, where we hear, "You are a chosen race, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, God's own people, in order that you may proclaim the mighty acts of the one who called you out of darkness into God's marvelous light." Our baptism is the sign and seal of our cleansing from sin and of our being grafted into Christ. Through the birth, life, death, and resurrection of Christ, the power of sin was broken and God's kingdom entered our world. Through our baptism, we were made citizens of God's kingdom and freed from the bondage of sin. Let us celebrate that freedom and redemption through the renewal of the promises made at our baptism.
I ask you, therefore, once again to reject sin and to profess your faith in Christ Jesus and to confess the faith of the church in which you were baptized. Trusting in the gracious mercy of God, do you turn from the ways of sin and renounce evil and its power in the world? If so, answer, I do.
All right, wait. So this is the second time you've done this morning, right? So you ought to be able to offer it with some conviction and knowledge. It's like, we already gave you the notes to the test, right? So, all right, again, some of you, I've seen you on the field, right? We've heard you here. You can be really loud. These kids can be really loud. It can be if they want to be, all right? So with conviction, let the angels hear what you believe.
We'll start again. Trusting in the gracious mercy of God, do you turn from the ways of sin and renounce evil and power in the world? If so, answer, I do.
I do.
There you go.
Do you turn to Jesus Christ and accept him as your Lord and Savior, trusting in his grace and his love? If so, answer, I do.
I do.
Will you be Christ's faithful disciple, obeying his word and showing his love? If so, answer, I will, with God's help.
I will, with God's help.
Amen. This is a time not only for these before us to affirm their faith, but for the whole church to affirm our faith together. And so if you are able, I'd invite you to stand and let us affirm our faith using the Apostles' Creed. With the whole church around the world, let us confess our faith. I believe in God the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended to heaven and is seated at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From there he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting.
Amen. Amen.
I encourage you to stay standing as they offer one more affirmation.
You have publicly professed your faith. Will you be a faithful member of this congregation? Share in its worship and ministry through your prayer and gifts, your study and service, and so fulfill your calling to be a disciple of Jesus Christ. If so, answer, I will with God's help.
I will with God's help.
And we get to do a tradition we haven't been able to do for, I think, 2 years or so. And the tradition is that the confirmands go down the aisle of the church and spread out. And we're able to offer them prayers as a congregation. If you'd like to put your hand on them or raise your hand towards them as an offer of prayer, we'll be doing that in a moment. So I invite the confirmation students to spread down the green aisle.
That's right. That's right. Again, let's gather around them. Put a hand on their shoulder or their head. Or at least raise a hand towards them as we pray.
Friends, in this room, we have a sense of joy this morning. I hope you can feel it as well. Joy in Christ, joy in the eternity. So let us pray with these new students and for them. Lord, we thank you for these students that you've put under our care as the church. We thank you for their parents who've raised them in your way. Lord, as they were baptized and we stood as a church and saying that we would be with them, be with their parents, support them in the faith, we pray that you give us the perseverance to continue to do that. Lord, we are your body and now they are members of this body. Wherever they go, whatever they go through, Lord, I pray that they know they are never alone because you are with them and by extension, this church is with them. And Lord, I pray that you give them joy in Christ. So whatever circumstances they find themselves in life, they know that they have the kingdom of God underneath them. Defend, O Lord, your servants with your heavenly grace, that they may continue to be yours forever. We pray that for these students. And daily increase in your Holy Spirit more and more until they come into your everlasting kingdom. And we pray that in the powerful saving name of the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen.
Amen. Congregation and its worship and ministry.
Be seated. One of the ways that we journey together as a congregation is by praying with and for each other. So I want to remind you there is a continually updated prayer list attached to our email newsletter. As soon as we hear about somebody who is requesting prayer, we put their name and some brief description of what's going on there. And so I commend that to you, that you could be praying for one another through these times. We know that there are a couple in our congregation over this past week who have lost family members. There are others who have endured surgery. There are others who are fighting cancer. You want to go and find that list and be in prayer for your brothers and sisters in Christ. I also encourage you to pray scripture for each other. And so this morning, in your bulletin, is a prayer guide based on the very verses that we were just looking at. And you could use this and insert the name of somebody that God puts on your heart so that you might indeed pray scripture for them. For truly, we recognize to be filled with greater knowledge and depth of insight. That means we recognize that God walks with us through wonderful times and very challenging times. And so we want to pray for each other in both moments. With that, allow me to pray. I will use this guide and lead us in praying for these young people. But you might use it for others in this moment and in the days to come. Let's pray. Oh Lord God, we do thank you for this life that you have given us together. We thank you, Jesus. You are our head. You are worthy of our life. You are the best. And Lord, we thank you that you have invited us into relationship with you. You've invited each one of us individually, but then, Lord, all of us together as a community to journey through this life until that day that you say your journey is over. We pray that you would sustain us, grow our knowledge, grow our understanding, help us to know your love in deeper and deeper ways, and to become more and more in love with you. Heavenly Father, we pray for these students that their love may abound more and more in knowledge and depth of insight so that they may be able to discern what is best and may be pure and blameless for the day of Christ. Fill them with the fruit of righteousness that comes through you, Jesus, to your glory and praise. We pray these words as you have taught us, Lord, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. God is the author of life. He's made everything that there is in this world, and he has entrusted it to us. And then to teach us to trust him in return, he asks for a portion back. And so in this time of offering, I encourage you to give joyfully and generously. Use the offering plates that are in the back. Use the online giving portal at the website. Maybe even set up a recurring gift. My family and I have done that, and we no longer forget every week. Whatever you do, give joyfully and generously as we share the life of Christ together. Your giving and our life is celebrated both here at the beginning, but also with those who are in the home stretch, if you will. One of those is Jim Foote. He's a good friend and brother in the church, someone who we have been praying for months, even years, along with his wife Barbara, who's right here. One of the traditions of the church that, again, was suspended during COVID was the tradition of singing songs of hope and life to one another, especially in challenging moments. And we're glad to be able to return back to that tradition. And so this afternoon at 12:30, if you would like, There is a group that will gather in the lobby at the Swan Creek, Ohio Living Swan Creek Retirement Community, and they will make their way up to the Foots apartment together, where Jim is ready to welcome you. He is on the bed in the living room, and we will together sing songs of hope and faith to both Jim and Barbara. 12:30 if you'd like to join in that. Let's now together close this time that we have in song. Let's stand and sing Lift High the Cross, hymn number 371. Thank you for joining us in worship. As you leave this place, may you, especially, but all of you, may you go with the confidence commended in Philippians 1:6. Be confident of this, that he who began a good work in you will carry it on to completion until the day of Christ Jesus. Amen.